We want to describe the functionality of the digital system, the functionality. So we earlier days, we used to do something like this, that is, truth table we used to have. So with the help of truth table, what we used to do is, we used to obtain, suppose say we have something like this truth table, for example. Yes, a simple example. You have A, B, some inputs here, and then some output here. So you use it to have this functionality in this format, that is truth table format. So after this truth table format, what you use it to do is to obtain what hardware is required so that this behavior I can see, what hardware is required for this. So we use it to go for, this is K-map. So this K-map, in this, we use it to have some inputs like this, and then obtaining something called Boolean expression. Something called Boolean expression. With this Boolean expression, we able to conclude something, suppose say for example, for this case, if we are obtaining something like A dot B. So this A, B, from this we use it to conclude that, oh, for this I need a AND gate. So likewise, we use it to conclude. This is a small example. So likewise, if you take a bit complex example, suppose say a 3-bit up counter, then we use it to have something called states. This is a present state, and this is a next state. Somebody joining, I guess. People joining late means again I have to go back here. So that's why I am requesting everyone ensure that before class starts you are joining. See, this admit problem I can avoid. So try to understand the problem. Later on they complain that you are not admitting us to the class. So we have to avoid this practice. Okay, coming to this here. Then we use it to have something like 0, 0, 0 is current state. Then my next state would be 0, 0, 1. And then if my current state is 0, 0, 1, my next state is 0, 1, 0. Like that, we use it to have this table. From this table, we go for something called excitation tables. These excitation tables are related to our flip-flops. So which flip-flop, every flip-flop will have is the excitation table. So from that we conclude that, so what is the hardware required? So some flip-flops required, in which fashion we have to connect them, and if here is the input of the flip-flop, so what additional hardware is required here, depending upon the functionality of this table. So this is manual approach. What we say, this approach is a manual approach. So this manual approach consumes a lot of time. So in order to avoid this lot of time, if we could able to write a piece of code, small piece of code, and this piece of code is a actually text format. And this piece of code, if we are giving to a tool called synthesizer, then the synthesizer, what it does is, it gives us gate level netlist. Gives us that gate level netlist. So this process, entire this process takes some few minutes. Earlier process will take few hours. So hours to minutes. So that was a simple example, a 3-bit up counter. But imagine if you are trying to develop a 4-bit processor. I'm just giving example. This was the Intel's first processor. So 4-bit processor. How much complex this 4-bit processor would be, and how much time it will take if we go by manual approach. So this approach is error prone also. This is an error prone approach also. One is time consuming, the other is error prone. So we can avoid this error prone by using something called here this text, again you write using HDL, the English like language, and you give it to a tool called simulator. This simulator, what it does is it verifies your intended functionality. You may be expecting here, suppose a zero at this time interval till here, from this time interval to this time interval zero, and this time interval to this time interval zero, again this time interval, again it is zero, and this time interval it is one, and something, this is say your A, this is, and you have something called B. So this is having here again zero, and here it is having some one. Again, maybe one again, maybe again one. So if it is an AND gate, then it should give here zero, it should give zero, it should give zero, it should give one. So this is called timing diagram. This is somebody trying to join again. This is the problem, guys. Please ensure. Oh my God, people are coming in between. So this is the this is timing diagram. And this timing diagram, as a designer, we know what is expected. So this simulator actually helps us within no time. We develop this text like behavior of a digital hardware, and then we give this text to a simulator, and simulator will do this job. So once this expected is correct, then what you can do is, this text you can give it to a synthesizer. Then you can give this text to synthesizer. Only when this first one is correct, then you can go for the second. This second one will give you the hardware. So that's how this is time saving. We can avoid errors, human prone errors. We can avoid time that is taken by manual approach. And it also facilitates the documentation. So these are the advantages that we have if we use this HDL. So this digital functionality is something, nowadays we have various digital systems, not only your CPU, that is your processor, microprocessor or microcontroller. You have, suppose for example, FIR filter, you have biomedical hearing aid applications. So these are a few which I named here. So all our digital systems, they have some specifications. We take some specification. That specification is nothing but the functionality, how it should behave. And this functionality, we put in a text format, textual format. And this textual format, we first give it to a simulator. And this simulator, it helps us to ensure that what we are actually looking is correct. It is giving that code that you have written. So once this functionality is ensured by the designer, having seen after simulator results, then he and she can go for synthesis. This synthesis will give us the digital hardware. So that is what this hardware description language is going to help us in that way. So this HDL, we have, is like a language, is like any other high level language. So then what is the difference that this HDL has got over any other high level language? Is basically it is having this parallel execution is possible, whereas your high level languages, they go by this way, sequential execution, meaning you have written a statement 1, statement 2, statement 3, statement 4, like that. So this sequential in nature, these high-level languages have, meaning unless you execute not statement 1, there is no way that statement 2, compiler can look into. But whereas HDL compilers are having that ability, because your digital hardware needs that. There are several, two flip-flops are there, suppose. They should work for a given clock, meaning these two flip-flops are working parallelly with respect to this given clock. So this parallelism is essential in our digital systems. So in such a way, this HDL compilers are made. So that is the major difference. So widely used HDLs are Verilog HDL and VHDL. So this VHDL, in this VHDL, this stands for very high speed integrated circuit. And then HDL, you know, that is hardware description language. You cannot acronym this Verilog HDL as VHDL. If you are taking it as a shortcut for this Verilog HDL as a VHDL, then you are making a mistake, because we do have two different languages. And this Verilog HDL, we don't have any acronym for that. So this one, lexical conventions are essential as a part of this HDL developer. This HDL developer, basically we call this digital system behavior, those who develop them, they are RTL developers, register transfer level. So they are RTL developers. So this RTL, I just go here again. That is RTL, register transfer level, RTL developer. RTL developer, RTL is one which is synthesizable. There are constructs in a Verilog HDL which are synthesizable. There are some synthesizable and some non-synthesizable constructs are there. Non-synthesizable constructs. So these two are here. This one are part of Verilog only. Both are part of Verilog HDL. So, but we use synthesizable constructs. If we are using synthesizable constructs to develop a digital hardware behavior, then we call it a RTL code. RTL code. Synthesizable constructs means those keywords of a language that are supported by the tool. Some keywords are there in the Verilog HDL. In subsequent classes, we will learn them. So they are supported, some are supported by the EDA tools. Some are supported by the electronic design automation tools to synthesize, for synthesizing. If they are supported by the EDA tool, these keywords, then we get here the gate level netlist. Gate level netlist will get. And there are some keywords which are not supported by the EDA tool for synthesis. They are called non-synthesizable. Those constructs are called, those keywords are called non-synthesizable. Them we use frequently in a test benches. We use them in test benches. At this point, those who are not aware with this, what is test bench, what is this keyword, what is the non-synthesizable, what is synthesizable, how we come to know what this EDA tool that supports and that doesn't support, all that worry is not required. In subsequent classes, we'll learn them, practically we'll do that. So, but at this stage, what we have to understand is, in Verilog HDL, we have some keywords that are supported by this EDA tool, for giving us a gate level netlist, meaning they are supported by the synthesizer. This synthesizer is a EDA tool, and there are some constructs which are not supported by the EDA tool. Them we call non-synthesizable. That much, if you remember, at this stage, that is enough. Now coming to here, or this one. So these lexical conventions are about that. We have to understand while writing a Verilog code. So why that gap is, what is new line means, are there case sensitive, like that. So this is the introduction about the language. So how to handle the language. So language is a free format language, means in any order you can keep the statements, not necessary one after another. We have to write them. That is not required. In any single line also, entire code you can write, or multiple lines also you can write. That is a free format language. Blank, tab, new line can be used freely. It means yesterday we have seen, and if you uh, if finding difficulty, then I have to go here. Like for example, those who are who joined here today, you know, for them I'm taking here, because yesterday few people have joined. They are familiar. What is the meaning of that? Suppose say for example, we have this identifier here, INV_OUT, then I am writing here the another one, INV_IN. After that, immediately I close this. So if I give gap here, what happens? That is what we are talking about. This one here. This one here. Can be used freely, meaning it's nothing to worry. There you can use. Space is allowed there. So that is anywhere if you feel like to have the blank, you can leave it like that. So that's not going to cause any problem. Verilog is a case sensitive language, meaning in that there are some language keywords are there, them you have to strictly use in a lower case. If you are using in a you know, upper case, then this compiler, Verilog compiler, is going to throw error. It's not going to accept. That is one thing. User-defined identifiers are there. Them you have to use strictly in your declaration. In your declaration here, suppose in your program here, somewhere you are declaring, for example, here if you go here, you have declared here with all lowercase, INV, all lowercase. But while using here, INV out here, if you are using this I uppercase, then you are causing a trouble here yourself. So trouble to yourself, meaning compiler will not understand. It will throw error that this capital I, uppercase I, and the lowercase all this not declared. Like that, it will throw errors. So that is that's what the case sensitive. So we have to be very careful about that. So then identifiers, we can, this is again one more rule that we have to follow. That legal characters are this lowercase all alphabets, uppercase all alphabets, this values, numerical values from 0 to 9, underscore, and this dollar. These are allowed. First character should be, can be, not should be, it can be an underscore, but it cannot be other than this underscore. Any other special character is not allowed. So for a few examples here, you can see them. This dollar cannot come before this file. So after this, it can come. But here in this example, you see underscore has come first. This, though this is a special character, but it is allowed in a Verilog HTML, underscore coming first. So that is the thing that we have to remember here. Other than that, coming to this one here, keywords, predefined identifiers. These are user defined. If predefined identifiers are there, they are the keywords. So as been said earlier, here is the case sensitive language. All keywords are defined in lowercase here. Cannot be used as identifiers. So you are suppose say if you are trying to use here the CMOS. Here, CMOS, suppose say output is a keyword. But CMOS as identifier, if you want to use, you cannot use CMOS as an identifier, because CMOS is a keyword in the Verilog HDL. So that is the meaning here. Keywords you cannot use as a user-defined identifiers. These are user-defined identifiers. So that is the meaning there. And we have here. So few example keywords are initial, assign, module. Them we will see while writing the program. You don't need to worry at this point. So comments are multiple line comments are like this. This is forward slash, asterisk, and then how do you end the multiple line comments? Again, start with the asterisk and then end with a forward slash. So this is how multiple comments are. But if you see single line comments, they are double slash. So that's how the comments are. One announcement to those somebody joined, I guess I have to go there and have to check again. I have to come out of this and I have to go here. I have to see this. This is the problem. If people are joining late, please see somebody. again they complain later on, you are not taking us into the class, like such comments will come in the group without understanding. So ensure that before time you are joining, okay? So this causes disturbance to other folks. So I was telling that one announcement, yesterday those who have joined, please bear with me, because few people have joined newly. So for them, I am again explaining this. Those have yesterday attended this session, if they can bear with me. So let us continue. So that's how these lexical conventions are there. There are a lot many like that. If we keep going that way, this slide I will share with you. Because what I believe is, instead of discussing this theory, okay, knowledge is required, how to use this and all, but that much is not required. Practically, if you do, then things will be clear automatically. So that is what I believe in. So this slide I will share, you can go through that. Quickly, we'll cover this one, some important. So some system tasks and functions we should be aware of. For example, if we have dollar time, we have dollar monitor, dollar display, dollar stop. These are some are system functions, some are system tasks. So what happens is, this system function will return something. I will tell you what it returns. System task will not return anything. So for example, if you take this one here, this dollar time is called system function because it returns a simulation time. The current simulation time is handled by this dollar time system function. So this dollar time is a inbuilt function of the Verilog GL. It's not a user defined. So that's the reason dollar can come first here. So dollar time, along with dollar only it should come. So dollar time is a system function. What it does, it returns current simulation time. Coming to this system task here, for example, you have this dollar display, dollar monitor, seem to be same here. Monitor and display seem to be same. But what is the difference between, while you write test benches, at that time, more practically you will understand, but theoretically what I can say is, suppose, say, you have something here. I have to go back to demonstrate this one here. Suppose, say, you have something to display. For example, so you have A equal to 0 and B equal to 0. This is, let us say, at T equal to 0, it is happening. At T equal to 1, what is happening is A is still 0, but B is becoming, let us say, 1. And at T equal to 2, this is A is becoming 1. B may change to 0 or it may still continue like 1. But what is that you notice is here, at every simulation time here, from T0 to T1, you see the change in a B here. In this case, you see here between T1 to T2, you see the change here in a A. So meaning, the changes we have to capture and we have to display here in the console. You want to see what is really happening at T equal to 0, at T equal to 1, at T equal to 2. Every change, if you want to see, then you must use that dollar monitor. The dollar monitor is a system function. Sorry, system task. So this dollar monitor is a system task. The ability of this is, every change that is really happening, really taking place like this here and here, in this case here. So every change is captured by this dollar monitor. Whereas a dollar display, only once during simulation, this dollar display, what it does is, your simulation is running actually from, according to this example, at T0 it started, it is still continuing at T1 also, still continuing at T2 also. Let us say at T2 it is stopping. Suppose, say, here it is stopping, your simulation, you are stopping here. So meaning what? At the beginning, when your simulation actually started, that is at time t equal to zero, at that time only this will be executed, this dollar display. Meaning whatever that is there here, these are captured and these are displayed in the console here when t equal to zero. But as simulation is progressing from t zero down to here, some changes are taking at every simulation time. Some changes are taking place. These are not captured by this dollar display. Whereas dollar monitor will capture all such changes. That is the difference between this dollar display and dollar monitor. So we have to understand them very clearly so that they are very helpful for us in test benches. And coming to this dollar stop and dollar finish, they seem to be same. Stop the simulation and quit the simulation like that. English language wise seem to be same. But what is that really happening is, a dollar stop, what it does is, you are performing your simulation. Suppose say you are performing your simulation. So we'll see that later on. So you have written your test bench out. So you are thinking that at 100 nanoseconds, at 100 nanoseconds, you thought of stopping your simulation. So what is that you can do is, you simply can use hash, this is the delay operator in a Verilog HDL, and then you can use 100, and then you can use here dollar stop. So if you use this way, what happens is, you have your OS operating system. Inside this operating system, you have installed your Verilog compiler. Your Verilog compiler is inside this operating system. So if you use this dollar stop, simply a waveform window that the simulator will pop up, wherein you see your input output results. At dollar, it will pop up this, and at 100, it will simply stop your simulation. That's all. That is what happening with dollar stop. If you are using dollar finish instead of this dollar stop, if you use here dollar finish, then what happens is, this Verilog, Verilog, as I said, it is there inside your OS. Since this dollar finish you have used here, this dollar finish job is, it will prompt, a prompt will come instead of showing this window, instead of showing this simulation result, it will throw a pop-up window to you asking that whether simulation you want to terminate, yes or no. Meaning control is given to operating system in this case. When dollar finish is used. When dollar stop is used, control is not given to the operating system. It is still there with a Verilog HDL, and Verilog HDL pop-up will come, and this pop-up is a simulation window. Somebody joining here, I guess. No, someone has come here. So that is what the difference here between dollar stop and dollar finish. If you people have any doubts in between while I am explaining, you can stop me and you can ask your doubts. Otherwise, I will continue. Assuming that you are not having any doubts. Okay, let us continue. So we are with this very, very important, guys, these concepts are, because in the test benches they are really helpful. This they all are helpful for us. So now coming to the compiler directive, equally important, the way system tasks and functions are important, these compiler directives are also important. So these component directives I am not going to explain here. Why? Because while practically, while we are doing, at that time I will explain. But what is that at this point I am going to explain is, the syntax is backcode. You see here tiny backcode here just before D, there is a backcode here. On your keyboard, you will see above the tab key. Above the tab key, there is a key. So that key facilitates this backcode for you. So that syntax is use the backcode and then define, and then depending upon the this compiler directive, this will change here. In this case, backcode define, you have something called name, something called macro text. This I will take up practically. But coming to the another example here, backcode include, there are many compiler directives, not only this listed here, backcode define and backcode include. And there are not only this here, system tasks and functions, there are many. But at this point, what I am trying to convey is, these are important while we write test benches. We have something called system function, something called system task. We must be aware as a Verilog, HCL, language known persons. And compiler directives, these are also important in test benches. And in a huge project if you are carrying out, at that time these compiler directives are very handy, so they are very much helpful. So backcode include, so this one I will take out. For example, suppose say you have this, for example, you are writing a one file. This is a one file, let us say one file. This file name you have given ha.v. In a Verilog HCL, the extension is .v. So inside this Verilog file, there is a half adder code. Okay, this is one file. Let us take another file. And this file, you say this time, this file name, fa dot v. Inside this, you don't want to write any logic here. You just want to make use of this file contents. Because we know using two half adders, we can build our one full adder. That concept we know, because we know the theory a lot. So that we can ensure here. This is the sum comes here. This is one A, one B, one C. And this will give us a carry. And this will give us actual sum. And another carry will come here. This carry and this carry, both are given to a one OR gate. This OR gate output is actually carry out for us. So here what you understand is one half adder is used here and another half adder is used here. So what you thought is, you don't want to write here that functionality of the full adder. Instead, you just want to make use of this functionality which is already written in a ha.v file. So you are instantiating half adder. Instantiating this terminology, you don't need to go panic. I will take up later on while we do the labs. So, but at this point, you simply have to understand there is a term called instantiation, meaning calling. So, suppose say the name here in this I have given module name is a HA. So that HA name I am using here, that is called instantiation. So, if I use this in this file, how many times I had to use? Two times, because here two times I am using this half adder, right? This is one time, and this is another time. So I had to instantiate one more time here. So in this file, how is that compiler is going to know the meaning of HAU actually mean this one? There should be a means. There should be some means that compiler should be aware that you mean this HA means actually you are actually referring to this module. So that is what we do with a backcode include, and in a double quotes the complete path name of this file. That way this compiler directives are helping us. They are very much helpful for us. So at this point, that much is enough. Backward define several other compiler directories. As we progress, we will learn that. So now coming to very quickly about this integer numbers, we have two methods, two approaches to represent a number. One is sized integer, the other is unsized integer. So I just want to ask, yesterday somebody attended, I don't know their names, those who attended, can you unmute yourself and say what is the other name for this sort of representation? Can someone unmute and say, I said, I was telling you yesterday that the other name for this is something I said. Can someone able to recollect and say who attended yesterday? Can you unmute yourself and say the what is the other name of this? Oh, no one responded. Am I audible to everyone? Are you people there? Suresh, are you there?
Yes, I am here. Yeah.
Okay.
Hi, Jackie.
Other guys who attended yesterday, someone can help? Someone can help who attended yesterday, because I am just repeating. The reason for repeating is, yesterday I did a blunder mistake, that is sending a WhatsApp message through that what we call the broadcast. So because of that, many people couldn't able to attend yesterday. So that's the reason I today formed the group. So yesterday I said this one. Okay, I don't know whether you people are there or whether unable to recollect the reason, I don't know. But this is called base format system also. This sort of representation, the sized integers, we can represent integer either way. One is sized integer, the other is unsized integer. This sized integer, we also call this one as a base format system. In this base format system, the syntax is, first the size will come to represent this value. What is the size? How many bits are required? For example, 15 if you want to represent, then I need 4 bits. So 4, I put the size 4. And then this is a tick. This tick in your keyboard, it is just above the shift key. Right hand side you have on your keyboard, there is a shift. And above the shift you have enter key. Left to that enter key, there is a quote. Double quote and single quote. The single quote will work in a Verilog HCL compiler as a tick. Earlier I was talking about this one here, backcode. This is not a tick. Technically we call it as a backcode. This backcode you will find on your keyboard just above the tab button. So compiler directives, wherever you see anything started with a backcode, then definitely it is a compiler directive in a Verilog HCL terminology. Similarly, if you see this sort of number, where you see this one, a tick, technically in a Verilog HDL, books are calling it as a tick. So this tick and then base. This base could be B or it could be O for octal. It could be D for decimal. It could be H for hexadecimal. So anything lowercase or uppercase will do here. This B could be uppercase, this O could be uppercase, this D could be uppercase, this H could be uppercase. So for example, let us go to again this here, our writing sort of means here. So I was yesterday, I took the same example. Today also I'm taking the same example. So 15 is a number for us, it is a number. Say, because we are conversant with decimal numbers, a decimal number system. So I just put here decimal. So what are the other ways in a Verilog HDL? A number can be represented. The other ways are, one is in a binary format you can, in an octal format you can, in a hexa format you can, in a decimal, default is a decimal only. That also you can do. I will tell you what advantages this base format system has got over without base format. Directly, assigning, suppose you have some variable x to which can't assign 15 directly like that. Means there are some advantages, there are some disadvantages. So I will tell now in this explanation. So now in a binary, I can represent this 15 as a 1, 1, 1, 1. So this is my binary representation. Some sound. See, still people, we are about to wrap our session, people are joining. So very, very disappointing, disgusting also. Okay, anyway, so let us come to this one here. This is one. Now, in the base format system, how do I represent this one? In base format system, as been said, first size will come. So what is the size here? 4 bits. So 4. And then what is there if you see this one 4 after size? A tick is there. So that tick. After tick, what is there here? Base is there, base. So we have to tell the compiler that it is in a binary format. And what is there after that? The value is there, binary value. So binary value is 1, 1, 1, 1. This way I am interested. Now the advantage, disadvantage, likewise, anything is possible here. Anything. For example, this hexa format if you take. So in a hexa format, this one is F. So this is hexa. So to the compiler, I will tell that according to this followed method, this same method, first size, this F, what is the size required when it is represented? So that is again the 4 bits only. Size. So 4 or tick B F. Oh, sorry, this is H and then M. So I was telling you that this H can be a lowercase or uppercase. So it could be like lowercase, also no problem. So advantage is, suppose say I have something here in a declaration. There is a variable, say the size of the variable is 3 tick 0 and then this is A. I will tell you what is this, this square brackets and 3 and then here is a colon and then 0. Everything we'll see later on, but you don't need to go panic at this point. This is a vector, simply a vector. And the vector size is 4 bits here. So in this, if I assign something to this A, if I assign something to this A, what is the maximum that I can assign here? Because 4 bits. So what is that maximum with 4 bits I can go up to? I can go up to 15. Somebody, somebody answered. So that is the 15 with 4 bits. So if I assign something like 16, what happens? So this is 1000. So these 4 zeros are assigned to this A. And this one is discarded. So advantage, I was telling you about the advantage. Advantage is, while this format, if instead assigning this way, if you have assigned this way to the 4, like 4 tick B 1, 1, 1, 1, then compiler is already being feeded with information that, Baba, you assigned to this A only 4 bits. Only 4 bits. We have already instructed the compiler. Compiler don't need to break its head. So, don't need to break its head means what it does is compiler. Suppose, say, if you have installed a Verilog compiler on a 32-bit operating system or 64-bit operating system, internally, if you don't use this method, that is base format system, it tries to allocate for this 15 total 32 bits, meaning all MSB bits, all zeros, and then finally 1 1 1, like that. In 64, all zeros here, and then finally 1 1. So this is extra burden to the compiler assigning like the unwanted assignment. We can tell the compiler, Baba, you don't bother about that. You treat the number like this way. That's it. So this advantage, where do you see, is a huge complex CPU for developing. For example, you can consider a 8-bit microprocessor. You are, suppose, say your project is BE project is a 8-bit microprocessor using a Verilog DL. You have to develop a 8-bit microprocessor. Suppose you are trying to simulate, the simulation time may be comparatively increasing if you don't take care like this sort of some techniques. If you don't take care, then there will be a considerable time increment that you see in a simulator will be taking. So in order to avoid this, we have to tell the compiler that you don't need to take all that 64 or 32, you just take only this limited. So there where this base format system is going to help us. The sized integers are going to help us. More elaborately, we'll see them in a while writing, some programs. At this stage, that much is enough, because it's again theory is the base. The theory is literally believes the required, but not that much. So, coming to the other way around here, such numbers where the decimal are there, then you can define in a scientific notation, for example, like this 3.6 E2 you can put, because E is 10 here, 10 to the power of 2 sort of thing. So if you don't want to have this way, in a cut short way also you can write that way. All these are, again, I'm telling you, in a synthesis we don't use them. We use them only in a simulation to test. Why and how we'll see in a subsequent classes. And then very quickly we'll grab, because we are reaching to the time here, wrap up time. So the value set here is, we have 0 is 1, that is for logic 0, 1 is for logic 1, and there is the unknown, how to handle unknown with X. If there are high impedance state, how do you handle with the Z you handle? So with the value set that is there, that are there in the Verilog HDLR 4, unlike your VHDL language, some 9 or more than 9 value sets are there. So those are value sets. How these are going to help us in developing a digital system, we'll see while really we develop the Verilog HDL code, while writing the code. So with this, I just stop my session. I just take few questions so far. Data types, again, it takes a lot of time here, because I have to let you know all this, everything, what it is, how it is used. Yesterday, I took up this actually. Today, I thought of taking up what is wild logic, wild OR means what, wild AND means what. But very unfortunately, because as I said, I did a mistake that is sending a WhatsApp through that broadcast. Many people couldn't able to receive the class timing, so they missed. So that's why I repeated again to the yesterday's attendees also, so that the newcomers, newly joined, they can benefit. Hopefully they benefited. And so far in this discussion, if you have any doubts, you can ask. But before you ask any questions, I just want to tell everyone that if you really looking for this, if you want to really learn this one, you have to have